begin with, the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance welcomes everybody and thanks you all for attending to do this event and for spending your money. MHLA would not be possible if it weren't for the fabulous volunteers and generous donors. The New Hampshire Liberty Alliance is an all-volunteer, nonpartisan, nonprofit political watchdog group dedicated to preserving their freedoms and improving public policy in New Hampshire. We are truly citizens and taxpayer advocates. I'm speaking over people who are talking because I'm on a strict schedule here. It's Evelyn's need for control. I guess I can be a little easier. The New Hampshire Liberty Alliance bill review process is probably the best in the country in doing what we do. Trained volunteers read, rate, and review nearly 1,000 bills each legislative session. Several trained, designated NHLA members act as citizen lobbyists at the State House. Testifying at hearings, promoting the often unheard message on how liberty is encouraged or trampled on by a given piece of legislation. For those of you who don't know me, I was a police officer here in New Hampshire for 11 years, and there's a lot of force used to enforce victimless crime laws, and it's a very real thing. We recruit and educate individuals interested in running for office by our informative Becoming a State Representative guide. In addition, we offer candidate training workshops that teach potential candidates how to run an effective campaign, including how to file, find volunteers, create impactful literature, and election day pointers. NHLA is driven by principle, not politics or party. We fight against special interest legislation and demand accountability and transparency at every turn. We want government to be vastly smaller and less costly than its current state. We respect, defend, and promote the basic virtues of self-reliance and voluntary charity, the very traits that make New Hampshire's tradition what it is. Our signature document, the gold standard, is a liberty cheat sheet for legislators. Volunteers compile and distribute to its State House representatives prior to every session. Our political action committee endorses and supports pro-liberty candidates and causes with money and volunteers. We believe it is critical for New Hampshire voters to understand how their elected officials represent them in Concord and to support those who work towards individual freedom. The annual Liberty Rating report card is for all 424 legislators on how they voted in relation to the Liberty Principle. Ratings go from A to F to constitutional threat. We will pass out the 2012 Liberty Dinner edition this evening. There's some very important highlights that the NHLA has for the last year. Many of the endorsed representatives saw their bills passed and become law. Highlights are HB 222, sponsored by Representative Lambert, a good friend of mine and a good man. House Bill 222 would eliminate broad-based rulemaking authority of several state agencies. And Chapter 541A goes way too far. That was excellent. Senate Bill 266, Senator Forsyth and Forrester, and Representatives Manus, Kirk, Balsario? And Cumberford, that would require written permission before the installation of smart meters. House Bill 1571 from Representative Hull, and Senate Bill 372 from Senator Jim Forsyth and Representative Gerwin, that would provide greater educational freedom for New Hampshire families. What could be more important than the choice you make on how to educate your children? House Bill 146 from Representative Christensen that would allow the right of a jury to judge the application of the law in relationship to the facts and controversy, which is not necessary. NHLA trained dozens of new citizen watchdogs to read and review every piece of legislation. Who else does that?
No one.
NHLA assisted several New Hampshire individuals and families in need with non-governmental, voluntary financial donations from the Civic Action Fund. NHLA mobilized citizens on several key pieces of legislation, such as the jury nullification law, recording public officials, medical marijuana, expanding Second Amendment rights, and homeschooling. NHLA has even led tours of the State House and taught participants about state legal procedures. NHLA assisted citizens in drafting new pro-liberty bills and networked with other pro-liberty organizations on both the state and national level. I don't think there's an organization like NHLA anywhere in the world. Before we begin, I'd like to recognize the leaders of the NHLA, specifically its chairwoman, the wonderful Eileen Landis. The absolutely excellent research director, Dan Gartley. Political director, Anthony Pug. If I mispronounce things, just remember I'm Polish. It usually works. Sometimes people... The Civic Action Director, Jean Marie O'Hara. Membership Director, Emily Sambley. Treasurer, Steve Valet. And the secretary, Jason Sutherland. Now, NHLA, obviously being a political organization, has several allies and associates that are state representatives. Some of them are here tonight, and we would certainly like to recognize you, if you would please stand. All state representatives. NHLA would like to give special recognition to Speaker O'Brien, who I too would like to give my thanks to Speaker O'Brien for being a steadfast supporter of the Redress of Grievance Committee. I have worked with many people who have been before this committee, and if it wasn't for Speaker O'Brien's leadership allowing this committee to stand, many people wouldn't have a voice, and I think for the work that he's done, he deserves special recognition. Some of you may know I'm running for sheriff in Coos County. Thank you very much. I believe that having worked 11 years in law enforcement, I believe that the office of sheriff exists for a specific reason, to be a check on the power of government. And I believe a lot of liberty can be gained by simply overseeing and making sure the government follows the rules and does things the way the Constitution, the courts, and state law says they should be done. And that's what I'm doing up in Coos County. If you're interested, it's bradforsheriff.com. And I'll find out how soon before dinner. Thank you. If I can have everybody's attention, please, so I may introduce tonight's featured speaker. A pessimist once said to an optimist, "Things are terrible. They can't get any worse." The optimist said, "Surely can." And with the state of police militarization here in the United States, things can get worse, and things are getting worse. The featured speaker tonight is a man whom, when I was told that I would be introducing him, I instantly knew who he was, and I was, being a fan of the Cato Institute, and I read a lot of their papers and listen to a lot of their podcasts, I recognized his name instantly. He's a man who's doing a lot to fight back against the militarization of the police. He's Mayor Cheye Calvo of Berwyn Heights, Maryland. A little information on him. He's a citizen mayor, first elected in 2004. Berwyn Heights is a small community within a county of 900,000 people. He spent most of his career in the National Conference of State Legislators, and he has a very interesting story, and I'm pleased to introduce him. Mayor Calvo.
Well, good evening. It's a great pleasure to be not only in New Hampshire, but at the Liberty Alliance in New Hampshire, which for those of you who were born in this incredible state and know it so well, it's being asked to come and speak to the Liberty Alliance in New Hampshire is like being asked to give a sermon at in the Holy Land. It's really. I can tell you it's a tremendous honor for me to be here, and I've enjoyed already having the chance to visit with so many of you. So basically what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to tell a story, and then I'm going to share a few assorted, hopefully somewhat connected, observations and thoughts about a very unusual experience that I had to go through. And I've spent a lot of the last few years thinking deeply about. And hopefully some of those lessons will be useful for you all here. So let me start with a story. It was July, 4 years ago. It had all the makings of a normal midsummer's day. As a part-time mayor of my town, I have a day job, and I had come home from that day job intent upon making a community meeting that night, which I was hosting. But before I had a chance to get to that community meeting, I had to go home and walk my dogs. That's kind of the deal. I had two wonderful black Labrador Retrievers, and my wife and I don't have children, so they were sort of our kids. So I arrived home that night, went upstairs, got on shorts, it was a hot summer's day, and was headed out to walk them. And my mother-in-law, who lived with us at the time, said to me as on my way out the door, just so you know, a package had been dropped off on the front steps. I didn't have time to deal with it, and she just let me know it was there. I didn't think much of it. But after I, made it back from my walk, released the boys from their leashes, I went to the front steps, which is not the door we entered in, and picked it up. Sure enough, there was a package, a big white box, addressed to my wife, valid name, valid address. So I brought it inside, left it unopened on a living room table. Went upstairs to get back into business attire. I got down to my boxer shorts and was about to put my dress socks on sitting on the edge of my bed when my mother-in-law cried out. It was a frightened scream. "Cheye," she said, "I think it's SWAT." In that circumstance, I really didn't have a moment to process that. So I got up and looked out the window. And sure enough, having just jumped the fence in my yard, there were three or four men that I could see, black masks, guns, surrounding my house. My head was spinning. But before I thought too much further, I heard the sound of an explosion. It was the sound of a battery ram breaking through my front door. It was followed by immediate gunfire. Bang, 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 bang. I heard the sounds of boots running across my floor. More gunfire. Bang, bang. I hit the ground. I was upstairs. I could then hear voices. Downstairs, downstairs. And then, sure enough, boots headed downstairs into my basement. And then, more ominously, upstairs, where I was. I cried out, "I'm up here. Please don't shoot." And I was given some directions. They told me to come to the top of the landing, me still in my boxer shorts. They told me to raise my hands above my head and walk down the stairs backwards. So with each bare foot reaching down to find the next step, I could look over my shoulder and see two barrels pointed right at me. I could almost feel them on my skin. When I got near the bottom of the steps, someone grabbed me. They pulled my hands behind my back. They put those little plastic handcuffs on. They led me across the living room, had me positioned me on the floor in front of the front door that they had just blown open. In the kitchen to my far right, I could see my mother-in-law, who lived with us at the time, face down in front of the tomato and artichoke pasta dish that she was preparing for dinner, a gun to her head. My older black lab, Peyton, 7 years old, I could see in between us, lying still in an enormous pool of his own blood. I later learned that my younger, and admittedly a slightly more timid black lab, had run to the back room, away from the men who mowed him down with the MP5 submachine gun from behind. The men in black, with their big military boots, were tracking the blood, which later that night I would clean up with my bare hands, through my house. That was 15 minutes into a 4-hour ordeal. And quite frankly, it was 15 minutes into a 4-year ordeal. But I also remember a moment of remarkable clarity as I kneeled at gunpoint with my hands bound on my living room floor. I remember thinking that there must have been a terrible, terrible mistake. Now, ultimately, of course, these men found nothing after tearing my house upside down to connect us to this white box of drugs. They said were drugs, I never actually opened the box. That they had been tracking from Arizona and had actually delivered themselves to my front door. It was kind of a sting operation that probable cause, you have to get the box in the house. Very quickly, my community, of which at that time I had been mayor, I was in my third term, now I'm in my fifth term, no one suspected us of being drug traffickers. My community rallied to our support on our side. It was, honestly, it was like living a Jimmy Stewart movie for us. Not everyone knew that, and this quickly became a media circus. About 8 days later, the county police, this was a county SWAT team operation, announced the arrest of a FedEx driver and an accomplice who were using innocent victims' names to ship packages. The FedEx driver would intercept them, and basically the innocent victims would, to work, would never even know the package was coming. The police knew about these type of operations, but hadn't really thought about that before they sent the SWAT team. Now, fortunately for us, I mean, my family and I were ultimately cleared, but not before the, due to, quite frankly, a great deal of good fortune, the story generated international headlines. It sort of became one of those two-day cable, early, CBS morning show sort of the conversations that brought a lot of attention. Now, I tell that story not necessarily because I want to generate your sympathy for me and my family. We're okay. We're fine. My wife and I are great. My mother-in-law, she struggled a little bit more, but she's doing well. And a lot of good has come from this incident. I can tell you that there were immediate changes. The media attention forced a great deal of attention in a conversation about SWAT teams. The Maryland legislature the following year passed the nation's first SWAT team oversight legislation, and it's really the first of its kind to actually provide a statewide mechanism to oversee SWAT team deployments. Just in December, my family and I settled a lawsuit with Prince George's County Law Enforcement that included meaningful reforms about how they will operate in the future. But most importantly, in a world in which injustices of this sort and many others happen every day, quite frankly, every minute, my family and I, we found justice much more quickly than most. Many people never find any sort of it at all. Yet I remain captured by the broader implications of the incident and what I've learned over this 4-year journey. And chief among those things is that my original thought and that moment of clarity, kneeling on my floor, that this was a terrible mistake, yet that wasn't actually true. It wasn't a mistake. It was, in fact, business as usual. It was just this time someone paid attention. And that lesson you know, for me is quite shocking. And it remains quite shocking. And so that's what leads me to sort of continue thinking about this. So, you know, I want to share sort of three general thoughts and observations. And I just want to, you know, put these out for you, and hopefully they're useful. One, I want to talk about SWAT teams and how SWAT teams are now being used for things that just used to be done by ordinary police officers. And sort of the whole militarization of police is something that is far more common than anyone realizes. Maybe not people who live in the wrong zip code, but for most of us who are fortunate enough to live in more middle-class communities, we may have no idea. Secondly, I want to talk a little bit about assigning responsibility and thinking through how we deal with instances of government dysfunction and government mistake, and how we, you know, deal with them constructively, and how too often we deal with them in ways that aren't as helpful. And finally, I want to end on just the subject of leadership, and how, you know, and maybe share some ideas about how, I think these things can be prevented everywhere, including here in New Hampshire. So first, let me talk a little bit about SWAT teams. Now, I didn't know much about SWAT teams. I'm a policy wonk. I spent most of my career working for, as it was said, the National Conference of State Legislatures, policymakers. I'm familiar in Washington. I've been a mayor for now 9 years. I worked in local government. I'm familiar with how government works, but I hadn't really done a lot on SWAT teams. Certainly, it's not something that my community police deal with. I mean, my community, we know each other. We're sort of like a diverse modern-day Mayberry. But SWAT teams, as I started thinking about this, I started talking to people and reading up on the matter, I started to realize, and just talking to people about how common they were in my county. And it was a member of my county council who's a good friend of mine. He told me that the year before our SWAT team incident, that Prince George's County, a county of 900,000 people, a fairly large county, had deployed SWAT teams 700 times, twice a day. That shocked me. And so I had to learn more. So, I mean, I thought about SWAT teams probably like you would kind of figure. I took, just based on common sense, I mean, SWAT teams were really emerged in Los Angeles in the late 60s, sort of out of the civil unrest of the 60s. In the 1970s, they began to be developed more across the country, more places had them, but they were really for the high-risk situations that you would expect. Barricades, bank, hostage situations, bank robberies, riots, things that are, where some type of, special tactical unit might be appropriate. But really things started to change. Well, and really what kept them in check in the 1970s is the same thing that keeps a lot of government in check, which is the fiscal policy. State and local tax dollars were not going to go into heavy militarization. It wasn't something that was going to be a priority over other things in the 1970s. But unfortunately, something fundamentally changed in the early 80s. It was the war on drugs. And so where state and local governments didn't change their thinking about SWAT teams, actually all they did was establish them under this pretense that they were going to be used in very rare situations. What happened, though, in the 1980s, the federal government began pouring money into the war on drugs, promoting the militarization of police. And there was lots of ways they did this. They started surplusing defense apartment equipment. One of my neighboring communities, City of Greenville, they have a tank that they got from the defense department. Now, fortunately, they've only used that in parades and other things like that. But sadly, I can tell you an unbelievable number of stories where these types of equipment are deployed regularly in communities. Like the kind where the guy's out with the rapid fire, guns in our communities. And that continues to this day. It remains a policy as a defense department. It's part of the, you may have thought that the war on drugs is a metaphor, but that the DOD didn't get that message. But there are other things in place. The federal government continues through burn grants and other federal grants to pump money into what are often called multi-jurisdictional task forces, which are basically is a SWAT team. That's really what they mean. Community may be too small to have their own, but they do it through this federal grant and they all participate and they're out there. They do it through asset forfeiture laws, where through the civil courts, not the criminal courts, they go in and they basically say to the person on the other side, you prove to us that these aren't ill-gotten gains. And when you do that, we'll give them back to you. In my county, Prince George's County, they have a $7.4 million slush fund that's essentially there. It doesn't get the sort of oversight from local and state officials because it's sort of treated like a grant. It's under federal authority, not under state authority. And there's no, usually, people haven't thought, well, what are we doing to make sure that there's some civilian oversight for these, you know, pools of cash that are used? Because the police, quite frankly, they kind of like SWAT teams. A lot of the guys, you know, it's interesting, it's exciting. It's much more interesting than community policing that I make my guys do. So there's sort of that natural tendency in that direction. If not given civilian oversight, you get it. So, you know, these things really do play out. And as part of, you know, bringing this back to my case, what I quickly learned in the months after my incident is Prince George's County had several years previously, actually more than a decade previously, adopted a policy, well, it was a practice first, and they formalized in policy, that every search warrant is executed with a SWAT team.
Oh, wow.
That's crazy. They've been doing this for 10 years before they showed up at my door. So when you ask the question, why was a SWAT team there? Because the SWAT team was always there. It's what they did. And what's interesting in the data we now have due to the law that was passed in 2009, 70% of the time that a SWAT team is deployed in the state of Maryland, which last year was about 1,650 times. Every 70% of the time, they force entry. Regardless of the type of warrant, they force entry. In Prince George's County, where the majority of SWAT teams are deployed for what are called Part 2 offenses, basically non-violent felonies and misdemeanors, which is often drug possession, by the way, is a Part 2 felony. So they're deploying them for strange reasons. In Prince George's County, when they deploy, my home county, hundreds of times a year, they don't make an arrest in half the cases. They're kicking in doors more than they're actually getting the bad guys. And this is a policy that may work really well for Home Depot, but it's not the sort of thing that, you know, should guide our public policy going forward. And this sort of brings me to my second point, though, is that what's actually really interesting about this is, you know, I'll be honest. This is, I'll speak personally here. After these guys did this, and there was a moment where I got a chance to sit in my living room where, for reasons that are still unclear to me, like 10 of these guys stood around my living room, and I got to see their faces. And part, you know, a great deal of me wanted to, well, a part of me wished them ill. You know, I really, this is their job, but I knew it wasn't personal, but I wanted to think less of them. I wanted to think they were bad people. But ultimately, I had a remarkable opportunity that few people who experience this type of misconduct from police get, is I got to go into a civil lawsuit. I had a chance to sit across the table. My lawyer got to ask them questions for hours for each of them. I got to know all about them because depositions, if you ever sat through one, you delve into a whole lot of stuff. I got to tell you, they weren't bad people. I mean, 150 hours of depositions, I got to be honest with you. I had to get over that. They really, now a lot of them, I can question their judgment, I can question their actions, I could suggest that perhaps some of them weren't appropriate for law enforcement. But they weren't bad people. And they were probably all in it even for the right reasons. But ultimately, an interesting fact is that they were doing their jobs. And I think a lot of the problems we face actually result from what may be sort of a misunderstanding of how government works and what government is. This is complicated. I'm trying to summarize this quickly. But in a sense, government, people try to make too much of government. What government is, it's a system of administration. It's function-driven. It's not mission-driven. I mean, it's bureaucratic, it's organic, and it's self-perpetuating. And let me unpack that a little bit. By bureaucratic, I don't mean that as a value judgment. It has a job to do. And in doing that job, it focuses on the task. It focuses on the function. You say, give people driver's licenses, it generally gives people driver's licenses. You say, you know, pick up trash, it picks up trash. You say, build roads, it builds roads. The policy is not driven from the bureaucratic structure. It's not a change agent. The change agent has to come from elsewhere, from the leadership. And secondly, it's organic. And quite frankly, I'll think of it almost like an overgrown garden. Like once upon a time, it worked so well because it got a lot of attention and was tended. But generally speaking, the great mass of what our governments do, elected officials aren't focusing on. It just happens. It just happens. It runs. And so, and it may have lots of weeds in it, but the berries are still coming out. We still go in and pick them. And it doesn't mean it's efficient. It doesn't mean it's effective, but it's doing its basic function. And we like to expand the garden, and we give a lot of attention to the new parts, the new policies, but soon enough we'll be gone and that part of the garden will be overgrown too. It just kind of grows, but it's self-perpetuating. That's the key thing, is it'll outlast the elected officials. It'll still be there. You know, the ability of a governor or a state leader in an important position to change government is very, very hard. It's self-perpetuating. I mean, it's sort of immune to the forces that affect the rest of our lives. You know, we don't get to, you know, continue just maintaining the status quo. In a dynamic world, we have creative destruction. It takes us out. I mean, let's face it, Rome took 300 years from its peak to decline. I mean, it's bigger than the purview of any one individual. And so when we talk about why government isn't working, we tend to focus blame on some individual. You know, we love to blame the politician at the top, who's probably not paying attention to whatever just went wrong, you know. And we like to assign blame to individuals because we're sort of an individual thinking society. But in truth, the problems of government are systemic. The guys in my case, they were just following the proper procedure. And what's interesting is the elected sheriff at the time, who is no longer in office, I'm pleased to say, he made a couple quotes that I've always stuck with me. They actually, at the time, they sort of stung me. He said, right after the event, defending his deputies who conducted the raid, he said, they did what they were supposed to do. And he later said they are operating to the fullest extent of their abilities. I actually think both of those statements are true. And the second one is a little bit scary because it can be taken in multiple ways, but they were doing their jobs, they were following procedures, and sadly, those procedures were followed. Why was a SWAT team there? Because that's what they did. They took thinking out of it. They extrapolated the thinking. They were just following procedure. They were just doing the ordinary. The police unit that sent the SWAT team to my house, what they did to my house was partial interdiction. They did it 3 times a week, 150 times a year. This is what they did. The lead detective said, you gotta understand, the reason we didn't do enough of an investigation to know he was the mayor is... I forgot that detail. But we don't do that. I had probable calls coming in the mail. All I had to do was get that box inside that house, and I had what I needed to go in. It was the job of the judge who signed the warrant, who was responsible for civil liberties. I'm pretty much quoting. The investigation starts when we get inside the house. He said it in the deposition in such a normal way because, again, he did this 150 times a year. This is what he did. And no one ever told him to do something different, which it brings me to the final point, which is that of leadership. Because it sort of struck me. I mean, I think I spent the early weeks after this event really expecting someone to say, we're sorry. Which they, 4 years later, and I guess a signed settlement, they refused to say it to the end. I was more interested in reforms than I was about the apology, but the apology was actually one of the most difficult things for them to consider. But beyond that, it's actually, if you ever follow police misconduct in the paper, it's interesting. It's actually, there's a textbook response. Something happens, something gets shot, the police promise an internal investigation, they circle the wagon. Typically, elected officials stick their heads in the sand and don't want to question police authority. And often, if it gets, they attack the victim. They attack the victim. And let's face it, most people this happens to live in the wrong zip code. Often they have some record. What happened in my case? I was a clean cut, I'll say it, white mayor with two beautiful black labs and an attractive family who knew how to talk to the media. And it blew out. But this happens all the time and no one paid attention. Because quite frankly, we outsmarted them. They were actually shocked that attacking my mother-in-law for streaming, which was the basis for them not, going to no knock and going to a dynamic entity, because her seeing them out the window threatened them. That's it, you said that. That was a policy. That's what led to that thinking. But what struck me is we too often rely on the police to oversee themselves. And I don't know why we would do that any place. And I've spent most of, like I said, most of my career for the National Conference of State Legislatures. I'm a legislative guy. I love state legislative government. I think that's where the real action is in America, where good ideas come from. A lot of bad ideas, too, but at least they're localized. But in truth, though, the sexy part of government isn't in the oversight. That gets ignored. They just let those gardens grow the weeds. And what, the whole government is out there operating, and people want to talk about other things. But I was sort of shocked that people I know for years, people who were my friends in the county government, wouldn't speak out to question the police. And I was a mayor. I was a first-term mayor. I had a police chief. It's hard to stand up to a police chief. But quite frankly, you need to exercise civilian oversight of all of government, but especially the people to whom you give a badge and a gun and the power to detain people. Because police shouldn't run free any more than the military should run free. There's a lot of things that can be done. It's not always necessarily new laws, but there are some good ideas that would be helpful. I think you all had legislation this year, and I hear it will be back next year to provide, it was in your report, about legislation that would attach cameras to the firearms of all people involved in the SWAT team. That's a great idea. Cameras have had amazing effect. Cameras have had amazing effect in vehicles, in interrogations, in making everyone act out in the open. You can't hide behind the story you tell the next day. You can't circle the wagons. It's on videotape. That's a great idea. It also, the goal is not to get people who do things that are bad. It's to prevent them from doing things that are bad. But there's a lot of things that can be done, but it begins by challenging the police. Not because they're bad people, because we live in a place where government working successfully is based upon checks and balances. And if you give people too much power, that's corrosive. That's not new wisdom, by the way, yet we seem to keep forgetting it. So what I would just say is, my lesson here is that there are some trends that happen. And left to inertia, the law enforcement in this country are going in a certain direction, and it's going in that direction for real reasons. It's not enough to see an incident and blame someone or fire someone or blame just the officer on the ground who may be just doing his job and may be an amazing officer, but because of one error in judgment. We have to get to the point that we're teaching judgment. We're not just making them robots doing unthinking policies because we want to cover our behinds against for liability reasons. We need to actually figure out how do we develop governments that think, that aren't just bureaucrats acting, that aren't just procedure driven. And that's actually really hard. And that requires a lot more of the conversations that probably happen at dinners like this than they do at what happens at the election season time. But government, as I say this as in my ninth year running a small town, where we've seen our crime at record levels and it's debt-free, and we've actually done some really great, exciting things in a small level, because that's where government tends to work best. Government can be better than it is, but it requires not just holding, blaming, and not just assigning individuals or firing individuals. It's thinking about things broadly and defining policies that we can work on together that are actually going to make things better, and some of those are often really simple. So with that, I hope that my story has been useful. It's a pleasure meeting you and talking to you, I'm happy to answer any questions or talk further later tonight. So thank you for having me.
The official name of having a video camera in the police cruiser. The official police culture name is Trunk Skunk. What are your thoughts on legislation requiring this?
It's actually really funny because initially the police are resistant to any sort of oversight. I mean, aren't we all? Is it just police? No, it's all of us. We don't want oversight. We don't want someone looking over our shoulder. The vast majority of us, like to be let alone. This is the Liberty Alliance, right? But actually what you found with police, where there have been cameras put in cruisers, which they actually have done that in Prince George's County, we haven't gotten them in the interrogation room, police actually really like them. Because what it finds is most of the people they're dealing with are in fact, or are typically criminals, and criminals do a lot to, incriminate themselves, but it creates an open, transparent process. And so in a world in which the technology has gotten so easy, where the basic technology is on our phones now, you can videotape a lot more, and what you find is it prevents the abuse, it actually helps the police, and the police come around to it. But what often happens is, state government, like all levels of government, is sort of that collection of interests, get a lot louder voice in the state capitol. And so when I passed my SWAT team oversight bill in 2009, working with legislators, the state police, chiefs of police, the FOP, the state sheriffs, all opposed it. And I can assure you, no lobbyist was paid in the making of that law. Well, at least not on my side. I was able to use my story going door to door. Keep in mind, I'm a part-time mayor. This was like another part-time job. I got a real job, downtown. But, but it was able to build something that was really grassroots. I had a lot of people who helped me to overcome that. But it begins with an understanding that the police chiefs don't own public safety. The police unions certainly don't own public safety. And you have to get legislators comfortable with the fact of bucking that trend. And a lot of that is, you have to put the context of what a police union endorsement means at election time. But generally speaking, after they get the oversight, they actually come to welcome it, and they try to take. Then you can't take it away because they actually see how it protects them as well as everyone else involved.
Can you tell us what reforms resulted from your incident, both legislatively and from the lawsuit?
Sure, absolutely. The three big ones the biggest one dealt with a decision about the unthinking SWAT team deployments. What was interesting about the statewide law for SWAT team oversight is we got really good data. Prince George's County is sort of the eastern part of Washington. Montgomery County is north of Washington. What we actually found when we looked at the data, where Prince George's County's numbers suggest a vast overuse of SWAT teams, that, think of about $10,000 per deployment. They're going 700 times a year. That's $7 million. When you're doing it for Part 1 offenses and you're not arresting people, even if you don't care about civil liberties, that's a tremendous waste of money. I happen to care about both, but the Montgomery County, interesting enough, all but one last year was for Part 1 offenses, more serious crimes. They made arrests in 90% plus of the deployments. So what we had them do in Prince George's is implement the risk classification matrix that it was a system that they used to determine when to use a SWAT team. It was basically exercising a tool to help them exercise better judgment. And so that was a big deal, and actually we've seen, it just happened in December, they just implemented this year. In talking with the new police chief, he's assuring me that their numbers are coming way down, and I think that's, for me personally, that's a huge victory on many levels. Secondly, I don't have time to go into sort of Fourth Amendment issues, but the defining exigent circumstances, which is the basis to get rid of a knock and announce requirement, which dates back to James Otis and, home to the castle sort of stuff. We have in the Fourth Amendment, there's a knock and announce principle that the police have to knock and announce themselves before entering your home. The loopholes to that were considered quite wide, and I think have been made wider by the Supreme Court, unfortunately. But the policies that were in place in the police and sheriff's department were crazy, to the point that 95% of their entries were dynamic, forced entry, which can be quite traumatic, especially when on the other side or someone who's just, watching TV and hasn't done anything wrong. So we had a new policy dealing with the entry policies. And the one that, I won't say it's the most important, but it's probably the one that's dearest to me, is Prince George's County had no policies or training for the non-lethal treatment of animals. And so when the guy came in the door, firing at Peyton and Chase, as gruesome as it was, there was no policies that they contradicted in doing it. They had never been taught that the continuum of force applies to animals, which continuum of force says you have to use the least significant form of force to get submission. With a human, it starts with verbal commands. They didn't have tasers, they didn't have pepper spray, they didn't have any training to deal with the dogs, despite the fact that most of my dogs were licensed with the county. You probably don't do that here in New Hampshire, but they do in Maryland.
Oh, no.
Okay, well, you got it. They never looked that up. But the point is, so now they are putting in place new policies and training and aligning training across the board. It's actually a really big deal. It's not very sexy, but it's a big deal to make sure that every officer operating in Prince George's County, which we're talking about thousands of police officers, it's quite a large county, will know these policies, and I think will do some real good. It's not the end all be all, but it's, for a lawsuit, is a pretty good step forward. Yes, ma'am?
Is there any change about the judge who was so willing to sign the warrants?
I think it's a really interesting point. The judge who signed my warrant, actually, the warrant itself, if you read my warrant, you would sign it too, because clearly my wife and I were drug traffickers. I mean, it was a stock warrant. It's, these things are boilerplate. The thinking that went into it was nominal. It was actually quite disturbing, in my opinion. The judge who signed it was horrified and was angry. And I think it speaks to the fact that the judges had no idea that when they signed the warrant, they were signing the SWAT team. And so the judges, I think, were complicit in not asking hard questions. And I think that was a lesson learned, that imposing standards on judges is a good idea, but the legal issue regarding entry, a search warrant, is where it has oversight. There was effectively no oversight of the SWAT team, so no one knew. So it brought a lot to light a great deal. I don't have any ill will against the judge. He, I know personally, was horrified by what happened. Yes, sir?
I learned in the last week, I've learned an incredible amount about police oversight, their shooting in Litchfield.
Sorry.
I'm a selectman in Litchfield. Some of you know that. Litchfield had a shooting on Monday night. Some of you know that. Yeah. We had a selectman's meeting Monday night. And I showed up to a selectman's meeting with more cars in the parking lot than I've ever seen. They were state police and other folks coming to investigate what happened. And so my initial reaction to that was really good. Someone's going to get to the bottom of this. I'm an elected official in Litchfield. You. I can't know what happened. The Attorney General's office can know. But it's our police department, I don't know. Nobody else who's a citizen can know. Just the Attorney General can know. Now, people who are calling me or sending me email or holding me accountable for what happened for a department that I'm responsible for have no idea that I, as a selectman who theoretically have access to what happens in my town on all levels, don't know. If we want to fix that, we are going to need to introduce legislation that makes sure someone outside of law enforcement is looking at what's going on in these investigations, because a week afterwards, it shouldn't be the police department and the attorney general are the only ones who know. What do you think of that?
I agree very seriously with that. And actually, I'll give a little more context. Maryland has a law enforcement officer's bill of rights. And quite frankly, I think legally in the state of Maryland, there's no more protected class than a police officer. If a police officer shoots someone in the state of Maryland on duty, they have 15 days before they have to talk to anybody. Seriously. I mean, you know, you can say due process, they can plead the fifth if they want, but that's a condition of criminal law. This is a condition of a personnel oversight. But the state of Maryland, in its, you know, in its, I can't even say it. has actually, of course, because the FOP lobbied for this. So, I mean, the ability, you know, 7 days afterwards in the state of Maryland, the police officer hasn't even given a statement. But there's a lot of laws and various issues with that. There needs to be greater oversight of police in general. And the way it often works is too often it's caught up in the individual instance. There are like citizen complaint, you know, citizen panels or citizen oversight panels that are put in place in all places, but most of them are teethless and meaningless. All they do is after the internal affairs report, they review it in most places. They can't really do anything about it. It's just a review process. You need to, and I don't know that you should be making everything public quickly. I mean, I've been in a situation where I've fired police officers. I've had to do it. Police officers have done some really foolish things. Again, good people in many cases, a couple not so much, but I've had to, it's a very difficult situation to be in. I don't want to, so I'm not saying these personnel reviews should be public. I think you have, but they have to have clear timelines for going through the process. I do think at some point it all should be public, but you need some sort of independent force how you define that, I don't know that I have the right answer, that's reviewing this, that has the ability not just to review what others have done, but actually ask questions, subpoena testimony, oversee it. And actually what always upsets me the most, this whole bad, just a couple bad apples sort of argument, what you typically find is if you start connecting dots, there are patterns, and you need something in place that's not just looking at individual instances, but it's actually looking at the broader context, because typically what that says is that there's a deeper problem. And usually it's in training. I mean, a bad couple of classes at the police academy, which we've actually had in Prince George's County, can cause decades of problems. If the training, if you don't have the proper in-service training, so the training they have to do on an ongoing basis every year, you're having serious problems. This stuff is mechanical. This requires good management. It requires making sure that everything's happening on time, and it's hard stuff. So don't just hire the most charismatic, police chief. Hire the one that has an operations understanding and hold them accountable and have real conversations about that and focus on developing middle management in the police department as well, because often their sarge is more important than the chief. Depends on how large the department is. But the middle management of government, I got to say, generally, is not very strong, and we don't focus much on professional development. And a lot of the problems, like a rookie cop making a mistake, may not be a fireable expense. The bottom line is, why wasn't he trained? Why was he in that situation? You just can't look at the individual. You have to look at all the circumstances, because his mistake may be, there may just be 9, 10, 100 other people who are just lucky they haven't killed someone today because they didn't get the training they needed. So you have to be dynamic in the way you think about these problems. Yes?
So I live at 10 Dane Street, Nashua. 2 weeks ago, a guy named Mark Connolly at 2 Dane Street, Nashua, he was a neighbor for many years before I lived there. He committed armed robbery at the local convenience store that he frequented all the time. He was in dire straits with his, his money situation and couldn't pay the bills for the house. And so I come home at like 5 p.m. on a Thursday, I believe it was Wednesday, and there are 5 police cars, there are a couple detectives unmarked cars, and they bring in a bear cat, which is one of those practically tank thing. And there's AR-15s, full camo, like headlamps, and they're running around in my backyard. They evacuate the homes next to it. And this is all, and if they called in the home, they call him, please come out and all that. And he won't come out. And the story goes, they sent in a robot at like 2 a.m., and they saw him, he killed himself. And, this is a guy who's probably an alcoholic, my guess, and I just questioned that response with this local who's had obviously a rough time, and he's known in the neighborhood, he wasn't that, bad of a guy up to this point. It was obviously that point. And then I wonder if this Montgomery County matrix for deploying SWAT would apply to the situation of armed robbery, and what do you think about it?
And I think I can't speak to the specifics of the situation. All I know is these things are hard. Police have a very difficult job to do, and I don't want to understate that. But I do think you're right to ask those questions, because that seems like a rather extreme response, especially, for me it was always, are they asking questions first? To me, SWAT teams should be the last resort, not the first resort. That doesn't mean they're never appropriate, it just means you shouldn't be getting there first. And you have to have more measured responses and think about it. I can't apply my judgment and second guess their judgment. What I can ask is, how did you get this judgment? How did you reach this judgment? I think citizens have to ask those questions. Yes, sir, in the back.
Thanks so much for coming, because this is critically important stuff. I lived in Prince George's County for my entire life until 2007, Charlie the Free State Project. one of my customers, I've got two different customers who are former police. One started his career in the mid-60s, and he said the SWAT stuff was just starting then. And he could see the problems of the roof. And he actually even spoke at the time about the problems of this, because he felt that the unspoken agenda of this was to intimidate the general population. As he mentioned, you got to do these perimeter clearing things. The whole neighborhood, move people here. You flick the police, you can end up dead. okay? And this actually within the parameters of what the police can do is to kill you for not obeying. You're supposed to move. So, and he thought this was very, very wrong. Well, yeah, I do too. And he's a police and he retired 2 years ago. Well, anyway, the point I'm getting to, and I don't want to be Captain Obvious, but the people who did that to you and your dogs and your family committed, if they had been wearing clothes like mine, they would be called criminals. And they'd probably spend a great deal of their time in a prison for what they did.
Yep.
Now, and again, being Captain Obvious here, but we'll be given the sovereign immunity, largely police have rights we don't have. It's a little like animal farm. They're more equal than us, and they're almost uniformly more equal than us. I don't know if those police who did that SWAT team, if they ever could even dock their pay. Maybe they're on administrative leave with pay, supported by a legal staff that they didn't have pay for either. They had behind them a whole structure that legitimized irresponsibility. I, as an individual, I'm going to be responsible for what I do. I don't want to hurt anybody. I know that if you sue, I can be thrown in jail real quick. It's really hard. Police will not be thrown in jail real quick. And that is obviously a key problem here. The sovereign immunity issue is huge. They have to be, everybody should be responsible for what they do. It's a libertarian thought, but it's one that I cling to. We all should be, but they are here.
Let me just end. This is my final thought. And everything in government requires oversight. I mean, I think, and it's a function that we have to give more attention to across the board. And hopefully, sometimes that oversight leads to stopping doing things that you've done a long time, but maybe don't need to do anymore. But it seems to me that if you're going to give oversight to anything, paramilitary units kicking in doors in our communities, that's not a bad place to start.
I'd like to give you all a direct quote from an instructor at the New Hampshire Police Academy. I've been to both of them. And for all of you that are elected officials here, I couldn't advocate anything more than getting involved in the actual police training and what police are trained. Because I was told by an instructor at the police academy, treat everyone as a best friend while you're coming up with a plan to kill them. So you get new recruits that leave the police academy, they're afraid of getting sued, they're afraid of getting killed, and unfortunately things like what happened to the mayor are the result. So this is something that I think all elected representatives should be involved with, especially the general court here in New Hampshire. So thank you, Mr. Mayor, very much for your presentation. We thank you very much for coming tonight. The auction.
50-50, yeah, 50-50, silent auction.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. You want to go back and sign up for it? Your last chance.
Yeah.
Five minutes. All right. Very good. 5 minutes.
And then I'll tell him.